Hello guys, Dr. Carlo here. I want to do a quick potpourri of a couple of the x-rays that I've gone through in the last week or so, and we'll have a little discussion of what we're finding. This is a hand x-ray on a patient who was involved in a fight and hit the other person in the head and has this injury right here. We're going to zoom in on that. And what you see is called a boxer's fracture, which is called a boxer's fracture because boxers tends to get it more. Is at the distal end of the fifth metacarpophalangeal joint, and you can see that there is fracture and there's also displacement volarly. When there's a lot of displacement, if it heals displaced, and the patient's going to have trouble opening and closing their hand mobility, so if they're a guitar player, piano player, any kind of detailed dexterity profession, it's kind of a big deal. But if it has normal activity, then it usually isn't. Now here's what you can get from this. In my own experience, I used to try to realign all of these, usually with a hematoma block. You just go with a needle right there at the fracture site. You inject lidocaine until it's numb, and then you pull on it and realign it, and then you put an ulnar garter splint, which goes and holds both fingers like this all the way around like that. But my experience is, number one, is that most of the time you don't get it realigned properly. Number two, if you do get it realigned, there's a good chance by the time they go to follow up with the orthopedic doctor, that bone has moved because of the swelling has gone down and now the bone has space to move. So by the time they follow up, it's moved and they need a procedure anywhere. So if you really need proper anatomical alignment, they need to follow up with an orthopedics and get the surgery they need, or the proper cast placement right from the get-go. So first, do no harm, treat the pain, put them on a splint, have them follow up with orthopedics, and don't try to reduce them. Usually I call the orthopedic if it's significantly angulated, I'll try to align it better, obviously, but if it's 20, 30 degrees, I let them be, I just have them follow up with ortho. Let's look at the next picture. This is a patient who actually, not too long before this picture was taken, had a small bowel obstruction and ended up having a partial colectomy. They have to remove part of the colon and then put a colostomy bag. And presents to emergency department because they didn't have any stool output from the bag in the last 24 hours and they started to vomit. The vomit smelled like poop because, sadly enough for the patient, it was poop. You can see in this x-ray that this is not a normal gas pattern. Normal gas pattern looks like that, just bubbles of gas. But if you look at the left side of the abdomen, over here, you see what is called the hostra on the colon. And you can see all the splicia is either small or large bowel. And actually, I'm kind of having a mental fart. I'm going to have to review the anatomy, which one's for small bowel, which one's for large bowel. But the point of this x-ray is that it's clearly abnormal. You can see almost coins stacked on each other here and here. That's obviously an abnormal gas pattern, kind of localized around the area where the patient has the bowel obstruction. So this patient has a bowel obstruction. This particular case, patient was admitted with IV fluids, an NG tube to suction whatever was in the stomach, and then most likely surgery to revise the obstruction and make them better. This is a wrist fracture. That patient had a foosh, F-O-O-S-H, fall on outstretched hand, and basically she was skating and fell and put her hand, and you can see the fracture right here in the radius. You can see the fragments don't align. Hopefully I have a lateral view. Yes, you can see that there's a large degree of angulation. You follow the bone like this, is almost 45 plus degrees angulated. This is called a Smith's, This is called a Colles fracture, C-O-L-L-E-S, and it happens when the deformity is towards the dorsal side. If the deformity is to the volar side or the palmar side, because they fall like this, then it's called a Smith's fracture. This one is a young person, and it needs to be aligned better. This is very badly angulated. When you talk to the orthopedics and you describe a fracture, you want to describe where the location is, whether it's a linear fracture, if it's displaced, non-displaced, if it's angulated, non-angulated, if it's opposed and percent opposition, and whether it's intra-articular or not. This particular fracture I would describe as a comminuted distal radial fracture with angulation towards the dorsal side, comminuted, I think I mentioned that already, I'm sorry, and probably going through the joint space. Probably, because I don't know for sure, but when you look at the lat, it probably involves the joint space as well. There could be a tiny little ulnar angulation fracture there, but the ulna looks pretty good. So that's how you would describe the fracture to the orthopedic physician on the phone. So this patient, we had to sedate so we can reduce her. She actually did not go down with the Comedic very well. She had a lot of like muscle spasms and stuff. So we had to give her propofol to really make it sleepy. She never did fall fully asleep, but I was able to reduce it and actually overcompensate that angulation until I thought I had it in place. I splinted her in place and then allowed the patient to wake up. Even though she moaned and groaned during the procedure, she couldn't remember anything. The last thing she remembers is what we were talking about before the sedation. And you can see that the fracture fragment is a lot better than before. You can see it kind of looks almost like normal bone, except it still has the lines there. And then we look at the lateral film, and you actually see what I use overcompensation. Because I was pulling so hard, I wasn't doing it under fluoroscopy. I just did it until I felt it was aligned. So there's still a little bit of displacement on that fragment, but the alignment of those two fragments, which was like this, now it's aligned. So I think this probably was not going to need any kind of operative repair or anything like that, unless the orthopedic thinks, once they follow up, that it is an unstable fracture. They might move, and they might put some pins and needle screws or whatever. This is not an x-ray, but I think it's nice to discuss overuse of opioids for headache treatment in the United States. It just says that basically the percent utilization of opioids to treat headaches has gone from 21% to 35% in the last 10 years. Yeah, I don't think you need an article to know that. That's common sense. We're using opioids more and more and more. Now, I wish we didn't have to. I wish we could always use Toradol and Ultram and non-narcotics and Decadron and fluids to treat all headaches. But the problem is, because other doctors are using opioids as well, then I'm forced to use opioids because nothing else works. They have many allergies and that's what they want. That's what they need to get better. And because we are getting pressured as emergency physicians more and more to move patients through the system, so you do want to give them a good dose of pain medicine so their pain is better and you can send them out after you know that it's just a migraine, that it's not nothing worse or whatever. And I think that's it for this video. I leave this for another video. We'll see you next time. Bye bye.